Hello everyone, welcome back to Auto Trend TV. I'm Avi Prajesh again from Ambal Nexa Coimbatore, and I'm here with the Maruti Suzuki Ignis. This here is the petrol 1.2 liter 4 cylinder manual variant, and I'm going to review this. Why am I going to review this? You may already know that the Maruti Ignis was initially launched in 2016 with exact specifications similar to a Maruti Swift. But this is a better car according to me, and I'll show you exactly why. So I am first going to give you an overall design impression and all about the interiors, and later I'm also going to drive it. So stay tuned. The Maruti Suzuki Ignis was always a controversial design with its SUV inspired all square design elements. It was kind of quirky, and is still quirky when compared with all the conventional hatchbacks and cars on the road. It has got that typical vintage kind of look at the back, especially these slats over here, the three slats which resemble Adidas logo. This was a highlight from the previous Ignis and all the old Maruti Suzuki models from Japan. And you may have already known that the Ignis gets 15 inch alloy wheels, all black alloy wheels. They look seriously nice. Now this is not a 2019 updated model. The 2019 updated model actually gets a roof rail. Roof rails are standard on the top end variants, but this here is a 2018 model in its blue color, and it looks seriously cool. The Ignis had almost everything you may ever need on a city car. You get projector headlamps on this top end alpha variant, along with front fog lamps with all chrome embellishment, and you can see that the massive grille is totally interconnected with the headlamps. You can see that the grille pattern is carried over around the headlamps as well, and you get daytime running LEDs too. Now this U shaped LEDs are really unique for the Ignis only, and they look seriously nice. The Ignis is totally unmistakable on the road, and it has also got the kind of butch elements which you might have seen only on SUVs, like the flared wheel arches. I know that these are not massive, but they look seriously nice and give the Ignis a nice stance. And also the Ignis gets a pretty nice ground clearance number as well. It has got around 180 mm of ground clearance, so that is also seriously credible, and that makes it really flexible for all kinds of terrain Indian roads have got to offer. Apart from that, you can see the typical square design elements, just like on any retro Suzuki car. You got nice sharp lines and angles and all types of design elements. It's really nice. I think that this looks seriously proportionate. The door handles are of typical Maruti Suzuki quality, and the overall build is also typical Maruti Suzuki quality, being light and really efficient, if I may. These rain visors are actually accessories along with the body stickering and that massive cladding. Yeah, overall this is a nice hatchback. And moving on over to the back, you can see that this is where the things get pretty controversial. I know some people may not like it, but I think it looks fine. It's not bad. It's definitely not as bad as the Ritz, but yeah, some people do not like it. You get a nice big size wiper for the rear, along with the washer and defogger lines as well. These tail lamps are actually split, but the thing is that not all of this tail lamp actually gets illuminated. Only this part is illuminated, whereas this is actually a reflector, and you get a small reverse bulb over here. This here is the indicator bulb. You get a nice Ignis badging, you get the Suzuki badging, and be it any variant, you do not get any kind of variant badging on any Nexa models, which is really good. Thing is that Nexa does not want you to differentiate or judge a person whether he is driving a top end variant or not. That is seriously cool, and Nexa started this trend. So yeah, and of course apart from that, you get reverse parking sensors along with a reverse parking camera. So yeah, the thing is, it's a nice looking car. Now I'll show you a nice wide angle side profile. So that is how the car actually looks on road. I know it's a bit quirky, it's subjective, the design is totally subjective, but I think it looks really nice. So that is my opinion. Do let me know, what do you think? So yeah, and of course I would like to thank Mr. Kalidas again. So he has been really helpful for this review in providing me the XL6 also on my previous videos, and this here is the petrol Ignis. He himself is a pretty good driver as well. So thank you, Kalidas. So next up, I'll just hop on into the interiors of the Maruti Suzuki Ignis. Yes guys, I am right now inside the Maruti Suzuki Ignis 1.2 petrol manual variant. And regarding manual variant, you can see that this is a 5-speed transmission. It's a really nice, slick, latest generation Maruti Suzuki gearbox, along with latest generation Maruti Suzuki steering wheel. The design is seriously, it's nice, it's functional, yet so retro, and I find it to be cool. And it's got nice design elements as well. You get round air vents for the sides, but you get square ones for the middle. And I think that the square ones are of really good quality. The middle, you get a standalone touchscreen, which is actually weird given that the lower variants do not get touchscreen system, but still the audio system is integrated with buttons on this mount. It looks weird, but on the top end model it just looks fine. This is the Smart Play Studio, which I'll explain a bit later. And next thing, you can see that this is the climate control unit. This is an automatic climate control. And this looks seriously upmarket, given that you get toggle like buttons just like on the Mini Cooper, and this has a pretty nice decent quality to it. I really like this quirky things. This is what makes the Ignis so unique. I'll just turn the vehicle on. You can see that the display is orange. I know it's a bit kind of a dated looking display. A white or something could have been a lot more tasteful, but still it's fine. The functioning of all the buttons is seriously nice. I know it's not the best, it is not as chunky as a Volkswagen Polo or something else, but this is fine. The design concept of this AC control, the console, is really good. Apart from that, you can see that there are a whole lot of dummy buttons over here, which is quite weird. I think that these buttons are actually for the multiple drive modes abroad, because over there in Europe and even certain other markets, you get the Ignis along with an all-wheel drive system also. Maybe these buttons are for that. You get a standard 12 volt charging socket here, and you get USB and aux ports over here on the right. You get decent amount of storage spaces. You can see that it's got a nice storage bay underneath, and you got two cup holders, which are small, but they are still fine. And this here is the transmission, this here is the handbrake, and there is a small tray underneath the handbrake to store a phone or some small items. But I think that this space has been wasted to quite a bit, given that if they had changed the design of a handbrake to further right or left, they could have had more space for further knickknacks. Well, no worry, because this is a compact car, and you get another big bottle holder beyond the handbrake lever. Coming to the steering wheel, this is a nice steering wheel. This was the upgraded steering wheel, which was new to India, and I think that now only the Maruti Suzuki Ignis and the Wagonr offer this kind of steering wheel. It is a nice chunky unit with thumb contours as well, which is really nice, and it's got steering mounted audio controls. Well, no cruise control on Indian models, but the audio controls are fine. They are really nice to use, and this here is the Bluetooth telephony controls behind the usual control wheel, underneath this one. This is a quite unique placement, just like on the almost all Maruti Suzuki models get this kind of steering controls only for Bluetooth telephony. But it's fine, of course, no leather wrap or anything, but it's fine. It's really nice and chunky to use, and given that this vehicle has already run around 21,000 kilometers in roughly 2 years, well, I guess 2 to 3 years, but still it's not worn out. I mean, it has got a bit shiny and rubbery, but it's still fine. And the next thing is that
the instrument cluster itself. It's a retro looking unit and I like the design orientation of this. This is a cool looking retro looking Speedo, and this here is the common taco. It's got a nice feel to it, and the MID is on over to the right. Well, sorry for the mileage, because this car has been running idle for quite some time, so the display of mileage is pretty low. Yeah, you get all sorts of display controls over here. You got instantaneous fuel economy, the average mileage, the range. Well, the fuel on this car is pretty low, so that's the reason the range is not being displayed. And you get average speed itself and also driving time. So this car has been running for 25 hours, I guess. Okay, fine. I guess that 25 hours, I don't know how is that calculated, but still it's fine. And of course you got a blank screen. Well, that's all. And moving over to the trip controls, you got trip meter A, trip meter B, and the standard Odo is over here, and this here is the fuel tank display down here. So yeah, it's a pretty easy to use system, and it's even got some kind of mood lighting over here. I guess that this will turn into some other color once you start pressing on with the accelerator, driving aggressively. And these are the controls for the MID, which is really nice, given that the older cars and even certain cars like the Ertiga and even the XL6 get those long tacky looking stocks to adjust the MID, to toggle through the MID. But this is fine. This is really nice and upmarket touch in this segment especially. Apart from that, you got the round AC vents, and over here is the start stop button, which is really nicely placed, just like on any other Maruti car. And this here is the reverse parking sensors, so you can basically turn them on even while you are going forward. That's also nice. This here is the headlamp leveler, and that's it. Well, I'll just get down to the pedals. The pedals are of course typical Maruti quality. They are exactly similar to my Maruti Suzuki Ertiga, or be it any other Maruti car. There is a nicely spaced dead pedal, which even for my foot size it's fine to use. The clutch has gone a bit hard, harder than you might expect, but it is still fine. Given that this car has run around 22,000 kilometers, it's fine. Well, it's got decent space and overall usability is totally fine. And you may also know that the Ignis is available with a 5-speed AMT transmission on the petrol variants as well as diesel. Well, the diesel is no longer in production, but the AMT on the petrol is still available. Next thing, you can see that the hazard indicators, the button is over here. You get a pretty standard size glove box. Well, the glove box may be of standard size, but you get an additional tray over here to store other things such as a mini lap or tab or anything. So that is fine. Of course, no cooled glove box yet. You got dual airbags on over there for the passenger and over here for the driver. The steering wheel itself gets tilt adjust only. No telescopic yet. It's fine for this price. And the seats themselves are really comfortable. I mean, these seats look exactly similar to the Maruti Baleno seats. They've got really nice thick bolstering for the sides and even for the seat base as well. And the headrests are really large in size, long in size, and they really support you very well. So this car is basically meant for youngsters. So that's the reason the engine is so responsive, and the seats are also bolstered according to that. Coming to the doors, and I'll just switch off the engine. Coming to the doors, you can see that the exact door is indicated which one is open on the MID. So that's really cool. Even though it's not a color display, it just functions like one. It's really nice. The door itself, I'll just give you a good look at the door. You got nice 1-liter bottle over here, and it's a dual tone theme all over the interior, white and black instead of a beige or beige and black. This is white and black. I don't know how easy would it be to maintain white on the interiors, but this car looks pretty well maintained. Even though being a demo car, it's pretty nice. You get the standard Maruti quality buttons for the power windows and mirrors, which I pretty much hate and I'm bored of, but they work, so why change them? That's what Maruti asks, I get, I guess. And this here is the chrome door handle, which is just like on my Maruti Ertiga and even on the current Ertiga as well. This here is another good look at the front seats. They are really nice, well bolstered, and even gets height adjustment on the top end variants. This here is the recline function as well. And the slide lever is over here underneath. You don't get lumbar assist or anything, of course, being in this price segment. Next thing, I'll just move into the back seat. Now you can see that the door shape itself is a kind of a squarish shape. So, okay, this is a weird kind of door, but that makes the ingress and egress so easy. You can see that it's so low and so wide. So even fitting a child seat will be totally easy. Regarding child seat, this here is the ISOFIX mount. So you get two ISOFIX mounts for, totally in four. You get four ISOFIX mounts so that you can fix even two child seats at the back. So getting into the second row, I mean the back seats of the Maruti Ignis, you can see that I have adjusted the driver's seat for my height. I am around 5'10 for reference, and I got decent enough room. Well, it's not great, but it's definitely really good for the size. And given this car's square shape, I have got great headroom as well. So I'll just show you. Yeah, you can see that I've got really good headroom as well. So that's really good and commendable. And even the rear seats has got adjustable headrests. That is a really good thing. Given that even the Grand Itin Neos gets adjustable headrests on the back seat, but the Neos misses out on front adjustable headrests, which is not really great. And of course, the seats does not get any armrest at the for the back seat, which is fine. Well, this car is meant for only front seat people, right? For this price, it's totally fine. This here is another good look at the dashboard. It is a nice and quirky dashboard. You can see that the touchscreen system is not oriented symmetrically. It's kind of aligned towards the co-passenger in order to fit the front AC vent. So it's a nice quirky interior. Once you get used to this interior, it will be really easy. I think it's fine. Given the quirky nature of this car, it's totally it totally suits the car's character. And yeah, it's a really spacious car, spacious in every way, and you don't get height adjustable driver seat belts, front seat belts, but you get 3-point seat belts for the rear seats, and the middle seat gets a lap belt only, which is the norm for all these cars. And even though the rear door looks totally plain without any kind of design element, looks totally plain and totally black except for this section, but you get a nice 1-liter bottle holder, which is really thoughtful from Maruti Suzuki. You get four speakers, and I don't think this car actually gets tweeters. Yeah, it gets tweeters. Okay, fine. So this car gets six speakers in total, which means four speakers and two tweeters. I'll just get to the touchscreen system right now. So first of all, when I start the car, the touchscreen system also switches on automatically. This is the Smart Play Studio system from Maruti Suzuki, which does not have any buttons except for the steering wheel for the touchscreen system. So even the volume control is kind of a slider control. So it's fine to use, is really convenient and easy to use. All the menus are available. All the often used menus are available right from the word go. So you got the power button over here. It's also mute function. If I long press it, the system gets turned off. And this here is the home screen. You get navigation as inbuilt, I suppose. Well, no navigation data. Okay, sorry for that. But music, it's available. You get FM as standard, of course. You get okay. Okay, so navigation actually requires the SD card inserted into this, but this being a demo car, that has been removed. That's fine. And you get contacts as well. Once you go to the home screen, you can see that the calls, the smartphone linkage, I think this is for USB, Android Auto or Apple CarPlay, and even Bluetooth connectivity. Everything is available on this system. So it's a decently really convenient and easy to use system when compared to certain other systems from, say, example, a Tata Tiago or something. But the sound quality is pretty average, I would say. It's definitely not the best, of course, not up to Tata Tiago or even a Ford Figo standard, but it is fine. It just does the job. Well, Maruti Suzuki has always been providing Nippon audio systems, and I think the speakers are also of the same quality from the same brand. So that's all about the touchscreen system. The AC, the cooling is really fine. I say it's fine because I have set the car AC in second speed of fan, but it's not so cool given the climate of Coimbatore. Is pretty sunny today, it's pretty hot, and this takes a certain time to cool, but it's fine. It's not the fastest, but it's fine. So next thing, I'll just get into the boot of this car. So the Ignis is actually known for its nice space management. So you can see that this car has got around 280 liters of boot space, so which is really nice. You can see that that is an XR delivery bag, and that is for reference. You get a nice square-ish loading bay, and it's fine. Although you get a pretty high door sill, the boot sill is pretty high, but it's a nicely managed space over here, really nicely managed space. And you even get an option of split folding for the rear seats as well. I know that even though you fold the rear seat, it's not a pretty flat loading bay. It gets a kind of a pretty massive step, but it's fine. It's a nice square loading bay, and you even get a boot lamp over here. That is really rare to see in today's cars. Only the Hyundai Creta has a kind of boot lamp, and only certain few other cars. You can actually fold the rear seats in total 60 to 40 split, which is not available on the Grand I10 Neos, even though being a new car. I must say that Hyundai has missed a kind of opportunity, but I think the Ignis has done it pretty well, even though not being so flat in terms of loading. The overall rear seat is pretty comfortable, the thigh support is okay, it's manageable. And yeah, I'll just get on to driving the new Maruti Suzuki Ignis. Well, it's not new, but it is a nice city car, so let's get on with the driving. So right now I'm here to drive the Maruti Suzuki Ignis petrol manual variant. I am driving this car because this car has been in the market for quite a few years now, but the sales are all-time low. But I think that this is a really perfect city car, especially for city conditions and this compact environment. So let's see how does this car fare in city conditions on road of Coimbatore. The first thing you may notice that the petrol engine is seriously silent. The NVH levels are exceptional. There is almost no noise or vibrations anywhere, be it on the steering wheel or the pedals or anywhere. And the clutch is also really progressive. Like, I am not even depressing the accelerator, not even a slight bit of accelerator is in use, but still I just release the clutch and the car moves. And once you start depressing the accelerator, the response from this engine is seriously, it's good enough, it's really responsive. The steering is like typically any other Maruti. It's light in the city conditions at city speeds, and it weighs up just that little bit for better confidence when you increase the speed. And even if I try to press on beyond 2000 rpm, the NVH levels are really good from the engine. But the problem is, the engine, though being so silent, you can hear everything on the outside. The exterior, the external noise levels from other cars, or right now I'm at a traffic signal, and you can see that almost 80% or 70% of the noise gets filtered through inside the cabin. So the noise insulation, the isolation of the cabin is not that great, given the fact that this car is basically a square cabin. The cabin shape itself is a square, so the noise levels get reflected inside itself. Well, apart from that, this is a perfect city car. It's light to use, you can easily see everything on the road. The overall view is exceptionally fantastic, I would say. You got very thin A pillar, and even the D pillar is, the C pillar is not actually a big issue. You can see
over to the back of me. It is a bit thick. The C pillar is actually pretty thick, but it's no issue. And the visibility from the ORVMs are also really good. It's a square ORVM and the visibility is good enough. The ride quality is also surprisingly fine. It's fine. I wouldn't say the best, but it's definitely fine. It works silently. The suspension works silently. The engine works silently. The mechanical part of this car is really well sorted out. The stability of this car is also not bad, given that at this speed it's fine, of course. All cars are fine at this speed. Now, that was a Scooty, and the noise of the Scooty, including the engine noise of that Scooty, was filtering inside. So that is what I'm talking about. The insulation of the cabin is not that great. But overall, the gear slots in perfectly. The brakes are fine, definitely. They are really good brakes. It gets ABS with dual airbags as standard on all variants. This being the Alpha variant, you also get ISOFIX mounts for the rear seat. And overall, it's a fine car. It's a really spacious cabin. So I think that this is a perfect car when you are using it for city driving purposes only, maximum. Because I don't think this car has got pretty good highway, high-speed stability manners, given that you have got a lot of faster cars going on highways, and especially the weight of this car. This is a pretty light car with a light-ish kind of build. Not too heavy, not too composed. Even though this car has got 15-inch wheels, I wouldn't recommend this car for highway purposes. So let's go on for a rough road now. Just take it to the nearby ground. So I'm right now driving on the grounds, well, the rough grounds of Kodishia in Coimbatore. And you can see that it's a rough ground. It's probably mostly used for cricket games and something else. Even on this rough surface, the ride quality is fine. It's pretty much absorbent and the suspension works totally silent. You can see all the stones and all the rough surfaces. Well, the good thing is that this car does not get tossed around, which means that you do not get tossed around even in the backseat. This car is not an SUV, definitely. This may have got the ground clearance of 180 mm, but this still is not an SUV. It's an SUV-inspired hatchback, but even for a hatchback, this is pretty nice. I think that you can take this car on almost all kind of terrain, except for the terrains which only an SUV with four-wheel drive can manage. Just like the XUV 500 you just saw. So, yeah, it's a pretty nice hatchback for all kinds of purposes. And that's what I think. Except for the external refinement. So, let's just finish this review once I get back.
So that was a brief test drive review of the 2018 Maruti Suzuki Ignis. And that's the reason I'm here at the showroom, to have a good look at the 2019 updated Maruti Suzuki Ignis. First of all, you can see that the addition of roof rails have made the Ignis look a bit more taller and gives it the much more road presence it needs, given the hatchback it is actually. Apart from that, there is not much of a design change or any update on the exteriors. Well, the thing is that the Ignis in 2019 gets only a 1.2 liter petrol engine. There is no option of a diesel. The diesel engine has been discontinued from production. So yeah, but still, this is a really good economical city car, good for urban and semi-urban purposes. Only thing is that it may be inspired from an SUV design, but it's not an SUV at all. So that's all. Let's conclude this review soon.
Test drive review.
can be used also for rough terrains given the ground clearance. It may have the light build-up from Maruti Suzuki, typical, but it is still better than on the Maruti Suzuki Swift. I think that this is an overall better car even when you compare with Maruti Suzuki Swift, given in all categories. This has the similar engine and has got even better economy as well. So if you are a person looking for unique identity and you want to stand out from the crowd, this is the urban car for you. So do let me know in the comment section, what do you think about the Maruti Suzuki Ignis? The pricing is on the screen right now for your display. Thanks for watching. This is Vip Rajesh signing off.
Watching this video, please subscribe for more videos. If you like this video, click the like buttons and give your comments.